Thank you, my one fan. That was awesome. It's like when you go to a Christmas concert and you're watching your kids and they're not really that great, but you cheer anyway. Thank you for that. I am thrilled to be with you on this first Sunday of the year. And God is so, so good, isn't he? God is so, so good. I just want to say that as we begin this year, whatever kind of year you're going to have, that the Lord is still good. And the Lord is gracious. The Lord is so full of mercy for us. Like, we don't deserve it all, any of it, right? But he is so merciful and so gracious. And so to kick off our year, we're beginning our week of prayer. And so this message really leads into our week of prayer, which is also a week of prayer and fasting. And so we're going to begin that tomorrow night. But I'll refer to that throughout my message. And so if you know, Northside is your home church and you plan on coming out this week, I just want to encourage you throughout this message to just seek the Lord's heart for what it is that he wants to say to you this week and do in your life this week. And tomorrow we're going to begin with a day of surrender, because we come to the cross. We come to the place where Jesus paid the price for our sin, our weakness, our sickness, our frailty. And so we'll begin the week that way. But before I open God's word, I just want to pray over his word, because his word is true, it is living, it is active, but I must apply it, amen? Amen. If you don't apply the word, it can just be a book, but if you apply it, it will transform your life. Father, we come to your word today, we come to your word this year, we come to your word in this moment, and we ask you, Lord, to speak your truth. Truth that transforms, Lord. I pray that as you deposit your seed in our hearts this morning through your word, we would not ignore what you tell us. We would put it into action, Lord. We thank you for your word that is living and active. I just want you to say to the Lord in your own heart, in your quiet voice, just thank you, Lord, that your word is living and active. Thank you, Lord, that your word is not dead. It is alive and active. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. Now, I realize with the title of this message that some of you are like, who are you to tell us how to pray? Like, I got my own thing going on. Well, you'll notice that the title of the message is actually in quotations, because Jesus said this. So if you have some issues with this message, take it up with Jesus, okay? All right, that's good. As we begin a new year, we posture our hearts in prayer. We posture our hearts in prayer. The Lord's Prayer, which we're going to look at today, which can be found in Matthew 6, is an effective way to pray. It's an effective way to pray and also to unlock great power in prayer. Jesus says to us, this then is how you should pray. What Jesus is not saying is this is the only words to pray. He's saying this is the posture that you should have in prayer. And he goes on to say this. He says, our Father in heaven. How many of you know the Lord's Prayer? How many of you have recited this many times in your life? If you come from Catholic tradition or other high tradition, you would have recited this probably every day of your life. But my hope and prayer is today to show you the different postures throughout this prayer that Jesus is calling us to have. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come. Your will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us today our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we have also forgiven our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from the evil one. That's not your spouse. That's not the coworker that you're having difficulty with. That's not your neighbor whose cat keeps peeing on your lawn. The enemy of our souls is Satan. deliver us from the evil one. And then he goes on to say, and this is why I like the Matthew version, for if you forgive other people when they sin against you, your heavenly Father will also forgive you. Verse 15, but if you do not forgive others their sins, your Father will not forgive your sins. It's a little heavy-handed, Jesus. The Lord's Prayer, it's often referred to, is not just on its own. This is water, by the way, not coffee. Our family's a little bit under the weather, and so I'm feeling a bit dehydrated this morning. My wife actually had to turn around and take the kids home because one of them was sick, so I'm just being open and vulnerable with you. You may not want to hug me after the service. I'm sorry for those I have hugged. I mean, I am realizing now that, I'm a hugger, right? I just had to hug somebody, and I hugged a few of you, and you might be squirming. I just pray that the Lord would protect you from all harm. Some of you are getting your sanitizer out. But the Lord's Prayer is found within the Sermon on the Mount. The Sermon on the Mount is not just the Beatitudes. The Sermon on the Mount is actually three chapters in Matthew, Matthew 5, Matthew 6, and Matthew 7. The Sermon on the Mount was not one 35, 40-minute sermon. It was probably days long. And the Lord's Prayer is found right in the middle of the Sermon on the Mount. Not only that, but the Lord's Prayer is actually between two other concepts. Jesus talks about generosity before, and he talks about fasting right after. And I believe these three are actually intertwined because Jesus says to be generous and to pray and to fast humbly. He says to be generous, to pray, and to fast like no one is looking. This is the theme throughout these three concepts. And what I thought to myself, I know we're going into a week of prayer and fasting, and we're saying to all of you, come to the week of prayer and fasting. But Jesus is saying these three things: give generously like no one is watching. Pray like nobody is watching. You don't have to use many words to pray. And Jesus goes on to say, fast, but, wash your face. Don't look all disgruntled so everybody knows you're fasting. And I believe this is actually a principle that generosity can unlock blessing. Prayer can unlock power. Fasting can unlock breakthrough, but done for the wrong reasons, done just in the image of the public opinion, they lack all power. Today I want to talk specifically about prayer. Jesus begins this prayer in Matthew 6:9. He says, this then is how you should pray. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Our Father in heaven, holy is your name. There's two principles here that he's showing us. Is number one, God is holy. That we should never lose our reverence for God. He is totally beyond what we could ever imagine in terms of perfection. He is so much beyond us as human beings. He is reverent, and I come into his throne room humbly and bowed before him. He is not just like a friend that I have here on earth. That concept of just friendship, God, without reverence is unbiblical. He is utterly holy. Yet Jesus is saying, but he is our Father. He's not just God far off. He is our Father. And Jesus is pointing out these two principles of intimacy with him as Father, yet reverence for him as holy. And when I come into his presence in prayer, I come boldly because he is my Father, but I come reverent because he is so holy. And Jesus says, our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. When Jesus says in heaven, he is not pointing out the distance between us and God. What he's actually praying is that heaven is near. Jesus is praying, saying that heaven actually comes near as we declare his name. Interesting, Craig Keener, who's a famous theologian nowadays, he points out, reflecting on the Lord's Prayer, he says that in pagan tradition, pagans would pray to their gods. They would pray to the deities. And there's many different gods that they would pray to. And what the pagans would do is they would pray to the different gods and they would remind the gods of all their sacrifices, hoping to invoke blessing from all of these gods. And so they would just remind the gods of their blessing. But Craig Keener goes on to say that we actually come to God as Father. We come to God totally different because he is our Father. Our Father is an intimate prayer. Many times in inner healing sessions that we have with people where there's been trouble or trauma or abuse from someone's father, they have great difficulty calling out to God as Father. Because that relationship has been broken or severed or damaged. But God is our Father, and he is a good Father. Our Father is an intimate place to pray from. Did you know that you can ask God questions in prayer? Did you know that you can come into prayer and ask God simple questions and he will answer? Because he is a good Father. Just last night, I asked the Lord a question. And I asked the Lord this question a lot. And I love this question for journaling. I said, Lord, how do you see me? I was reading over my notes, I was praying and just worshiping the Lord, and I just paused and I just said, Lord, how do you see me right now? And he said this to me, dressed for battle. And then he finished it, and this might make some of you uncomfortable. He said, dressed for battle, but undressed for intimacy. The Lord calls us to humbly come to him, undone. To humbly come to him, undressed in our soul. He knows your life. He knows where you've been. He knows what you're thinking. He knows that you might be falling asleep during this sermon right now. He knows. We come to him undressed in prayer. And he dresses us for battle. Now that's a word just for me. But the question you can ask the Lord is, Lord, how do you see me? He wants to be seen as Father. Next, Jesus goes on to pray, our Father who art in heaven, hallowed be your name. And then he says this, your kingdom come. Your will be done on earth as it is in heaven. God's kingdom is God's will. His will is established where his presence is experienced. We are to be carriers. See, prayer positions us to be carriers of his presence. When we enter into prayer in intimacy, we become carriers of his presence. And carriers of his presence mean that we carry the kingdom. And we become conduits for his will to flow through our lives. That God desires that each one of you would come into prayer to be equipped to carry out his will on earth as it is in heaven. Jesus is saying heaven can affect earth through you as you become conduits of his will. Prayer is God's way that he communicates his will. Have you ever used a walkie-talkie? I wanted to use it today, but you ever use a walkie-talkie and you're first learning how to use it and you just want to talk all the time, so you just hold the button down and you're just talking away. What do you have to do to listen to the person on the other end? You have to let go of the button, right? So they can talk to you. God is all about walkie-talkie prayer. But you can talkie-talkie all you want. But if you talkie-talkie all you want, that's what we do though, right? We just self-talk. I'm gonna get through this, I can do it, I'm gonna get through it. And we just self-talk, and God's like, take your finger off the button so I can reveal to you what my will is for you. And when we take our finger off the button and he begins speaking about his will for us, it may be very different from what you think it should be. But where his will is, there is his blessing. When I say the word blessing, I don't mean like wealth physically. I'm talking about the soul. That you be blessed in your soul. The battles we fight are not physical battles, they're internal battles. Jesus is saying, your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as it is in heaven. That means I come into prayer and I said, Lord, I want your will to be done in me as you have declared in heaven. God, I want you to show me what you have already said in heaven over my life. This week, as we come together to pray, I want you to be praying over God. God, what is your will for me? And what is your will for this church? And what is your will for this community? What is your will for my workplace? Next, Jesus shows us praying for provision. He says, give us today our daily bread. Everyone say daily bread. How many of you like bread? How many of you like fresh baked bread? A lot more hands went up. How many of you are gluten free? I see you, Gail. I see you. And I bless you. This prayer actually would remind the Jewish people of the wilderness and the manna in the wilderness. It would remind them of the concept that they had to rely on God each and every day for food, for sustenance. Each day they would come to the Lord, and the Lord would pour out manna for that day only. And on the Sabbath, he would give them bread for 2 days because they weren't allowed to work on the Sabbath. So when Jesus is praying these words, give us today our daily bread, what he's saying is yesterday's bread is not good for today. What he's saying is Jesus, he's saying God has fresh bread for you. Like the Father is up all night baking a loaf for you. The Father has nutrients for you, desires for you. I come to the Lord each day in prayer and I say, Jesus, I want to feast on you. Feast on your presence. Bible says if you come to the Lord and ask him for an egg, he won't give you a stone. Yesterday's bread is stone. He says, give us today our daily bread, Lord. Give me today, Lord, what I need to get me through today. Next, Jesus spends the rest of this prayer. This is where it might get a little prickly this morning for you. He spends the rest of his prayer about forgiveness. He says, forgive us our debts. Anybody have any debt in the room? Come on, it's after Christmas. You're gonna try to lie to me like that? I mean, credit cards, you have a car payment, mortgage, just normal stuff. That's all debt. I know we're all in it together, but it's all debt. We all have debt, right? Jesus points us to the fact that we are born actually soulfully and spiritually in debt. And Jesus says, this is how you should pray. Lord, forgive us our debts. But he goes on to say, as we also have forgiven our debtors, those who have sinned against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from the evil one. And 14 and 15 I find so convicting. For if you forgive other people when they sin against you, your heavenly Father will also forgive you. But if you do not forgive others their sins, your Father will not forgive your sins. Do you have people in your life that you have not forgiven? Some of you are going through a Christmas detox right now just with family. Are there people in our lives that we have yet to forgive? What Jesus is saying is when you come into prayer, the prayer of forgiveness, yes, it is for yourself, but it is also to say, Lord, is there anybody in my life that I need to forgive? I think Jesus is saying the posture that we have in prayer is not just that we would be wiped clean and cleansed and forgiven, but he's saying that you would also forgive those who have sinned against you. Let me ask you again, is there anybody in your life that you need to forgive? There's people in my life that I need to forgive. Now, this is a hard saying that Jesus is saying, I will not be forgiven, but what I think he's pointing out to is that unforgiveness provides access for the enemy to have influence in that area of my life. Jesus is saying that unforgiveness is not acceptable in the kingdom. Do you remember when Jesus hung on the cross? Do you remember when he was crucified? Do you remember what he said to the people who just killed him? Forgive them, for they know not what they do. I want to be forgiven. I need the grace. I need all the grace in the world, Lord. And the Lord's like, that's good, Joel. How about you also extend that grace to others? Now, why do we stay in unforgiveness? We stay in unforgiveness because it's justified. It's logical. It makes sense. The mind allows unforgiveness to be a justified response to a wrong. I'm going to give you an example, and this is not a true story. This is just an example. Let's imagine that my uncle told me when I was very young that I was stupid. My uncle did not tell me that. We had a great relationship, but let's just imagine for a moment that he told me, Joel, you're stupid and you're never going to amount to anything. Let's say that he told me that at 6 years old. At 6 years old, I started to believe that lie about myself. Fast forward a few years, I'm 10 years old, and my grade 5 teacher says, Joel, you really got to study harder to get better grades. Now, let's say that I view that through the lens of what my uncle said to me, and I say to myself, well, study harder. I'm just stupid. I'm never going to amount to anything. See, that unforgiveness at 6 creeped in at 10. Now, let's continue that forward. Say I'm 14, 15 years old. Say I'm 18, 20, 25 years old. And because I've never actually dealt with that unforgiveness at 6 years old, I repeat the pattern, and people say things that sound similar, but I just put them in the same box. What happens is that unforgiveness, even at a young age, controls me. Is it justified? Yeah, my uncle said that to me. Is it the kingdom? No. The kingdom says forgive. Now, some of you might be dealing with obviously much deeper issues than an uncle who has said that you're stupid. Some of us deal with abuse and trauma and all of that. And, And that takes time. And what I'm, hear me on this, what I'm not saying is that when we forgive, we forget. What I'm not saying is when we forgive that the person didn't do something wrong. No, the person really did something wrong. But what happens, how the enemy will control us is unforgiveness almost ties a string to that situation, that moment, that relationship. And enough strings begin to control us like a puppet. And so what forgiveness does, which Jesus knows because he's pretty awesome, he's God. What Jesus knows is that forgiveness of other people have done to us cuts the rope, cuts the chain, breaks those things off. Amen, Joel. That's good right there. That's pretty good right there. I don't need the amen for me, but you need the amen. You know what amen means? So be it. I agree. I want that for me. I take that. I don't need it for me like a clap, but you need it for you. Right, Rose?
Yes.
Amen. If you're new here or visiting, I just welcome you into organized chaos. But yeah, I just, for me, I respond to what the Lord's saying to me in worship and messages and prayer. We're a responsive church, so. I want to close with this because we're going into a week of prayer and fasting. And I want to turn our attention to the book of Nehemiah. It's in the Old Testament, just for a quick moment. I'm not going to share about Ephesians 6. I'm going to come back to that next week and talk about warfare prayer. But I want to talk about Nehemiah for a moment because Nehemiah is, he's in the kingdom with King Artaxerxes, the king of Persia. Can I get an amen from all the Persians? Can I get an amen from... Thank you. Thank you. There's a whole group of you. But Nehemiah is a cupbearer to the king. And a cupbearer basically means he eats all the food before the king does. He drinks all the wine and the drinks that come to the... I don't know what they drank other than wine and water. But he would drink it and eat it for him. And if he died, obviously the king would not eat or drink that food and drink, right? So, but some of us think that would be a horrible job. But actually back then it was very highly honored to be in that position. And Nehemiah was in that position. But Nehemiah hears that the walls of Jerusalem, his hometown, are burned to the ground and need to be repaired. And he goes into mourning. And maybe this is your posture right now. Maybe you're entering 2024 sad, in mourning, in grief, in fear, in anxiety. This is for you, okay? I felt the Lord show me. This is for those entering this year like, I can't take anymore. Nehemiah's for you, okay? Verse 4 of chapter 1. When I heard these things, when he heard the stories and the news about Jerusalem, I sat down and wept. For some days I mourned and fasted and prayed before the God of heaven. See, Nehemiah's fasting and prayer was a response to a condition of Jerusalem. Nehemiah's prayer and fasting was specific. And this week, some of you are going to come to our week of prayer and fasting with a specific need. Does anyone here have a specific need? that you are calling out to, I mean, specific. Specific. I mean, this is the one thing that occupies 80% of my thoughts every single day. I have a specific in my head. We fast. I felt this. This isn't always the case with fasting. I'm fasting this week for the specifics. I don't know what the breakthrough is supposed to be. I don't know when that, you know, healing is gonna come. I don't know when that, whatever it's gonna come. It may never come. But I'm praying this week and fasting for specifics. And I want you to do the same. I want you to maybe write it down, even though you don't need to. But you come in with that specific. Nehemiah had a specific thing that he was trying to do. He fasted and prayed that he would have favor with King Artaxerxes to be able to return to build the walls. So he fasted and prayed before going to see the king. Specific meeting on a specific day. He fasted and prayed for a specific reason. He says, Lord, the God of heaven, the great and awesome God, who keeps his covenant of love with those who love him and keep his commandments. Let your ear be attentive and let your eyes be open to hear the prayer your servant is praying before you day and night for your servants, the people of Israel. He goes on to say, I confess the sins we Israelites, including myself and my father's family, have committed against you. We have acted very wickedly toward you. We've not obeyed the commands, decrees, and laws you have given your servant Moses. What is he doing? He's coming in humble. He says, Lord, I remind you of this covenant of love that you have with us. And then he goes into confession. Lord, I confess our sins before you. I confess my own sins, Lord. I confess the sins of the people before you. And Lord, I ask you now to turn your ear toward your servant. This is the posture I feel that I have going into this week of prayer. Verse 11, let your ear be attentive to the prayer of this, your servant, and to the prayer of your servants who delight in revering your name. Give your servant success today by granting him favor in the presence of this man. I was cupbearer to the king. Favor. This is the specific reason that Nehemiah is asking the Lord for. And he goes before the king and he sees favor. Open doors. The king writes letters to give him safe passage back to Jerusalem. Because of the relationship, the king honors him. And Nehemiah goes back and rebuilds the walls of Jerusalem in 52 days. What's the point? The point I want to draw to from Nehemiah here is I feel this, that this week there's going to be specifics. And there's no promise or guarantee this week of anything. But I do believe that the Lord wants us to posture our hearts with fasting and prayer for those specific things. Specific prayers receive specific answers. Maybe you've never fasted before. Maybe you're like, what are you talking about? I just want to go slower. You're talking about faster. That was a joke. So fasting can be done many different ways. Sometimes the Lord asks us to fast something that just isn't good because of the amount, like Netflix, social media, chocolate, food, dessert. Sometimes you just need to go like 40 days without coffee. I did that last year. Lord have mercy. That's a tough one. I know how Jesus felt in the wilderness because I did it last year. I went 40 days without coffee. And I was led into great temptation. I'm going to share what I'm doing this week. This is not a pattern at all. You can fast one day, 24 hours from food, drink some water. You can fast all week from something that you do every single day, like coffee. I find with fasting, the Lord, this is a wonderful question the Lord always will answer. Lord, what do you want me to fast from? He'll answer it. Let him show you, let him guide you. Personally, all week, I am going to be, and I know I just said don't tell anybody about your fasting, but because this is a corporate fast, I think it's important. I'm fasting from 8 to 8 every day this week. So 8 a.m. to 8 p.m., nothing but water. You can ask the Lord for your own, but I really feel this as a church that the Lord is calling us to corporately fast. What's interesting is many other churches are also fasting. There's just, not even just within Foursquare, but it just, God is doing something this year with fasting. Many different churches across North America, probably the world too, but I know of many, many churches in North America that they're just feeling this call to fast. And so, would you join me in that this week? Again, you ask the Lord and seek his heart for that, but that is a prayer he loves to answer. And why do we fast? We fast because we starve the flesh to feed the spirit. We starve the flesh to hear God. We starve the flesh to heighten our senses of his presence and what he's saying to us and what he wants to do in us. That's one of the reasons why we fast, but there's many reasons. Well, church, let me pray for you, and then I'm going to invite Pastor Rose to come up and lead us in communion and the worship team and greeters to come forward to help us as well. Father, I pray that in this time of communion, you would continue to do what you love to do, which is just to speak to our hearts, Lord. Show us a part of this prayer, this effective prayer. Show us a part of this prayer that maybe we need to be strengthened in, Lord. Maybe it's intimacy, Lord. Maybe it's praying into your will for our life, Lord. Maybe it's the forgiveness, peace, Lord. Maybe it's an area of fasting you're calling us to, Lord. But I pray that, Lord, you would highlight an area that you want us to focus on more deeply this year, God. And I pray that even as we go through communion and have a time of listening to you, Lord, you would share your thoughts with your people. In Jesus' name, amen.